Hello, scientific writers. If you are watching this video, you understand that publishing your scientific research is important for your career and for your field and for society in general. Publishing your work can be what stands between you and finishing your master's or your PhD or getting a postdoc or moving into your next job or getting your next grant or even being tenured and promoted. However, you don't want to just publish anywhere. You want to publish in a good journal and at minimum a legitimate journal. You don't want to publish in a predatory journal because that's not going to be seen as a positive. That's going to be seen as a negative, and it's going to hurt your career, not help it. So let's talk about what a predatory journal is and then how to avoid publishing your work in a predatory journal. It can be hard these days to tell what's a real journal and what's not a real journal. Hi, this is Brian from the Grants and Publications YouTube channel. Thanks for joining me. Let's first define what a predatory journal is. I'd like to start with a quote from this publication, and this article was published in Biochem Med in 2021. The quote in the abstract says, "A predatory journal could be provisionally defined as one masquerading as a genuine academic publication, but offers little if any rigorous peer review. Predatory journals or publishers place a focus on maximizing financial profit as opposed to regulated dissemination of scientific advancements. As a result, authors can often get their work published in such journals with little scrutiny on quality." And that's why publishing in a predatory journal is not going to help your career, because nobody is going to take that article seriously. They're not going to respect it, and they're not going to find it credible. All right, so we've had a preliminary definition of a predatory journal. Let's look at some characteristics of predatory journals. They have peer reviews that happen too fast to be credible. So you might get it back in one day or two or three days. And it's just not possible to find qualified peer reviewers to review that quickly. They need at least 2 or 3 weeks. Another sign is that the peer reviews are not legitimately critical. And predatory journals will accept any manuscript, regardless of rigor or quality. And I've seen some exposés where authors have made up nonsense articles and submitted them to predatory journals, and they get accepted, even though the article makes no sense whatsoever and it's not scientifically valid. Another sign of a predatory journal is that it charges a fee. Now, however, legitimate journals often will charge a fee also. So take a look at my other video on open access publishing. I'll link it here. So this is a sign of a predatory journal, but journals that charge a fee are not automatically predatory journals. Another sign is that they mimic or impersonate established journals. So they might take the name of a very good journal and make a slight variation of that name so that it's confusing. And people might accidentally submit to this predatory journal that has a very similar name. A lot of times, the predatory journals will also have editorial boards of people that are not qualified to be on the editorial board, or they might even be made up people that don't even exist. They just fabricate names and list them on a website as editorial board members. And they might put on their website an impact factor, but that impact factor is not real. So if you want to know more about impact factor, check out my previous video. I'll link to that here. Let's look at a more in-depth definition of predatory journals. This is an article that was published in Nature. It's called "Predatory Journals: No Definition, No Defense." If we go deeper into this article, predatory journals and publishers are entities that prioritize self-interest at the expense of scholarship and are characterized by false or misleading information, deviation from best editorial and publication practices, a lack of transparency, and/or the use of aggressive and indiscriminate solicitation practices, usually in the form of spam emails. When I was a professor, I was getting 4 or 5 of these emails every day. So let's dig deeper. And I'm going to pull out some excerpts from that article. False or misleading information, they're talking about fake impact factors, incorrect addresses, misrepresentations of the editorial board, false claims of indexing or membership of associations, and misleading claims about the rigor of peer review. When we're talking about deviation from best editorial and publication practices, we're talking about not having a retraction policy, requesting a transfer of copyright when publishing open access, and not specifying a Creative Commons license in an open access journal. By lack of transparency, they're talking about predatory publishers often fail to provide their contact information or details about article processing charges. So they might not tell you the charges until after they've accepted your paper. And then they say, oh, by the way, you owe us $500. Editors and members of their editorial boards are often unverifiable. The fourth point in this definition, aggressive indiscriminate solicitation. This can take place as repeated emails that are excessively flattering in tone, or they might mention the researcher's past publications while noting that related submissions are urgently needed for a forthcoming issue. Clear warning sign is that the invitee's expertise is outside the journal's scope. So one clue that the journal might be predatory is if the article processing charge is really inexpensive compared to the other journals. Let's take a look at another article. This was published in the Indian Journal of Dermatology, Venereology, and Leprology in 2020. And a quote from this article says, an independent investigation on Indian predatory journals shows that the charge or fee ranges from $30 to $1,800 per piece or article. Global average estimate is $500 to $1,000 per publication. Now compare that with the average cost for publishing in legitimate open access journals, which is more like $2,800 to $3,000. That doesn't guarantee that the journal is predatory, but it could be a clue that tells you to dig a little bit deeper. A list of basic criteria for identifying predatory publications is found in this article. Some of these are similar to what we've seen before. Charging exorbitant rates for publication of articles in conjunction with a lack of peer review or editorial oversight, notifying the authors of fees only after acceptance, targeting scholars through mass email spamming, quick acceptance of low-quality papers, including hoax papers, listing scholars as members of editorial boards without their permission, or not allowing them to resign, listing fake scholars, copying the visual design and language of a legitimate established journal, fraudulent or improper use of ISSNs, giving false information about the location of the publishing operation, and giving fake, non-existent, or misrepresented impact factors. So those are some of the characteristics and things to look for to identify a predatory journal. But that's a lot of work, and you might not be able to find all that information. So is there an easier way? Is there just a list that you can look at? Well, there are some lists. There are what we call blacklists, which list known or suspected predatory journals or publishers. And then there are lists called whitelists, which are journals that are deemed to be legitimate or non-predatory. Let's take a look at this article talking about blacklists and whitelists. In this article, they say that predatory journals are spurious scientific outlets that charge fees for editorial and publishing services that they do not provide. Their lack of quality assurance of published articles increases the risk that unreliable research is published and thus jeopardizes the integrity and credibility of research as a whole. So this really gets at why publishing in predatory journals is bad for you, and it's also bad for science. All right, so there are these blacklists and whitelists. Where do you find these? One place you can find a blacklist is on this website called Scholarly OA, and I have a link to all my sources in the description below. Now, this Scholarly OA is a copy of what was formerly called Beale's List, and this was a list of journals and publishers. It was put together by the former university librarian named Jeffrey Beale. He took that list down in 2017, but this website took over and published that list. One of the criticisms of this Beale's List is that the criteria for putting journals on this list is not transparent. We don't know what the criteria are. And there's a problem with this website as it is at the time I recorded this video, because this link that says learn more about the criteria doesn't actually give information about the criteria. So we have to take it with a grain of salt, but it is a place to start. Now there is another blacklist, And this is put together by a company called Cabell's Scholarly Analytics. This is a screenshot of their website. This list is called Predatory Reports. It's a pay-to-see-the-list business model. So it could be if you're a student, staff, or faculty at a university, maybe your university library subscribes to Cabell's. What they do with the Predatory Reports is they analyze over 60 behavioral indicators along the themes of peer review, editorial services, policy, business practices, publishing, archiving, and access, their website, and their indexing and metrics. Cabell's also publishes a whitelist, and another whitelist can be found at the Directory of Open Access Journals. This article that we've been talking about in Nature has a figure in it that shows the comparison of the blacklists from Beals and from Cabell's and the whitelists from Cabell's and the Directory of Open Access Journals. There is only a little bit of overlap between Beals and Cabell's predatory lists, and some of the journals that are on those blacklists happen to be on the whitelists of the Directory of Open Access Journals. And there's one of them that's on the whitelist from Cabell's. So there is a gray area there. Some of these journals are not clearly predatory and they're not clearly not predatory. Another indication of the scope of the problem of predatory journals, there were over 11,700 predatory journals compared to 22,300 some legitimate journals. One third of the journals out there are predatory journals. It might even be more at this point. So what is the take-home message? Be careful where you publish. Put a lot of thought into that. And I have a previous video where I talked about some of the things to consider when you're choosing a target journal. I'll link that up here. Ask yourself, have I heard of this journal before? Have I read papers from this journal or have I cited papers from this journal? And if you're in doubt, ask some colleagues. And if they don't know anything, it's always a good option to turn to your university librarian and have them take a look and do a little investigating. They can give you a lot of information about whether that journal is legitimate or predatory. If you got value from this video, please hit the like button and consider subscribing to the Grants and Publications YouTube channel. If you want to hear more videos about scientific writing related topics, I'll see you next time and happy writing.